The number of actions that the segments can form are limited, so it should be no surprise when two seemingly unrelated stroke disciplines will converge to utilize similar trajectories. The vertical shoulder actions can be classified by trajectory too, similar to lower body movements, which means that there will be shoulder actions that aim for the midline, and there will be actions that avoid intersecting with the midline to create these relatively straight trajectories. Among the four strokes, breaststroke provides a fairly straightforward display of shoulder abduction and its vertical pulling partner of shoulder adduction. It is important to remember the concept of segment hierarchy, which means that the hands don't necessarily decide the trajectory. You can start with the hands at the front and still end up aiming for the midline, as long as you intentionally hit the midline. This also holds true with the breaststroke recovery that starts with the hands in front and recovers via shoulder abduction aiming for the midline. Let's compare these two recoveries. Why is the second example more ideal compared to the first example? Observe the arms in relation to the midline. The swimmer with the straighter angle is maximizing abduction better. In other words, the streamlining observed here is better. A tactile cue for sharp streamlining is the shark hold breaststroke kick. This is performed by palming a kickboard to encourage two major components of shoulder abduction. First, elevation of the shoulder. In the words of Bowman himself,
does a very good job of having his shoulders pulled up near his ears.
The cue of shoulder shrugging refers to shoulder elevation. Another tactile cue from doing the shark hold is internal rotation, which is the lesser known element that completes shoulder abduction. This is of course assuming that the kick mechanics are solid. Check this topic out if you haven't yet. Going back to shoulder abduction, think of it as a pushing type movement in the same category with push-ups, just with a vertical overhead trajectory. There's also an element of pushing the shoulder blade away, an element of screwing the upper arms in, and an element of core extension as counterbalance. If that covers the overhead action of the recovery, what details are we looking for in the propulsive phase? In these frames, we can see that the ideal breaststroke involves a pull that targets the midline for propulsion. Here's the catch. Textbook information tells us that adduction can be handled by either the back muscles or the front muscles. So in this case, which one do we want to favor? The answer? It's in the name itself. Let's work backward for further analysis. Recall that pushing actions usually require a combination of these three movements: extending, pushing, and screwing in. To arrive at this peak position, core extension makes sense. Additionally, this upper body orientation is only possible if we swap level 2 for a more appropriate vertical pushing action. Lastly, internal rotation from level 3 assures for better chest activation. In the words of PT himself,
water, always go round, and then look at my elbows. Okay, they're not like this.
The well-roundedness of this position is defined not just by the movement of the scapula in level 2, but also by how well the upper arm locks in via internal rotation in level 3. Let's walk one more step backward to analyze the beginning of the pull. If you remember our push-up video, we control the stretch shortening cycle by manipulating level 3. The same concept holds true for swimming. Before shortening into this position, a prior stretch occurs during the catch phase because of external rotation. This is a good time to emphasize a recurring concept of intention over form. We have introduced this concept in an earlier video, where these two seemingly different forms have exactly the same intention of core compression, just at different levers. While it may be easier to identify the intention of elevation when the form indeed looks like someone who is in elevation, we may have to think twice when the form still looks relatively overhead, but the intention is different. This explains why we still label level 2 as scapular depression. There is a similar intention of aiming for the midline, just at different lengths or levers. This is simply a stretch position that later has to be shortened. In a similar way, for level 3, the arms may appear internally rotated because of the thumbs down position, but we may have to think twice since we have established that external rotation is the position that stretches the chest the most. Manipulating proximal limbs in this context is like revving a car. Despite exerting effort in the right directions, because there is one segment that is acting as a braking mechanism, the chest will stretch first until you allow it to shorten. It may start to make more sense when we recall that the hands are a different segment. This means that the hands can press against the water independent of the other segments. The path to the midline must now overcome the water resistance caught by the hands. Think of it as prepping a slingshot. Speed is generated when the primary level actions overcome the resistance generated by the catch. To close the loop, the recovery aims back to the midline overhead. Again, intention is key. So how does this relate to freestyle? Rotation in freestyle involves some form of twisting at the core. Regardless of variation, one thing is for sure. The lats will be stretched during rotation. Remember how we can either favor the front or back chain? Using an end-to-end approach, we can see that the hands will catch the propulsive resistance first. The first level movers will rotate against this resistance, while the second level movers will pull down to also overcome the said resistance caught in level 5. The lats in the context of shoulder adduction prefers external rotation to lock in the movement. Propulsion occurs when we overcome the resistance from the hands through the primary level movers. Finally, observe how the segment combinations allow us to perform a trajectory characteristic of shoulder adduction. The same shoulder adduction which always aims for the midline. In the same sense for the recovery side, cues like shoulder to ear makes more sense since it is a translation of what shoulder abduction means, which is again convergent with how we recover in both these disciplines.